All right, let's transition to our next article, Jeff, and it's going to be from Alhambra Investments. You posted it on October 13th, and the title is Inflation Expectations is Anything But Confusing. And what we're going to try to get across to the audience today is that there are legitimate benchmark ways of measuring inflation expectations, despite what you may hear to the contrary from the Federal Reserve or from the financial press.
And remember, you know, starting out here, going forward, that inflation expectations in a monetary policy setting, at least the current monetary policy setting, they are everything. They don't believe in money supply anymore because they don't know what money is, as we talked about in the last segment. They don't even pay attention to most of the monetary system. So there's no money in monetary policy anymore. It's therefore defined entirely by inflation expectations, which, I mean, if you believe that, then as a central bank, or at least what we're told is a central bank, which is actually domestic bank authority, but it said if it's a central bank, then under inflation expectations paradigm, your entire focus is on influencing expectations, not actual inflation, but forward expectations. And so that creates a problem for you, because how do you know what inflation expectations are? It's not something that you have, you know, do you conduct focus groups? Do you have polls, surveys? What are inflation expectations? And it's a central question to the modern central bank, because it's not a central bank.
Well, the good news is that we can look back in history, and not too far back in history, and see a similar moment to the present. And you do that, you start out by taking us back to 2012 and 2013. Jeff, just remind us what was happening. There was a taper, QE3, QE4, US Treasuries, inflation, the bond route, the repo market. What was happening?
There's a lot about late 2012 and 2013 that show up in a lot of different things. It's an extremely important time period, and I think it's one of the most misunderstood and misinterpreted time periods too, because again, you know, the conventional narrative is something other than what the evidence says. Back then, you got to remember, QE3 began in September, or at least it was announced in September of 2012, started running in October. And then that didn't really work as well. We had all sorts of repo problems late in the monetary problems, repo problems, those kinds of things late in 2012. And then in December of 2012, they went to, it wasn't called QE4, but it actually is a fourth iteration of QE. So the Fed started buying treasuries again because it didn't seem to be working. So early 2013, we have questionable economic circumstances. Europe is in recession. The global economy seems to be falling off. Is everything going to recover? The Fed says, yes, everything's great. We're doing two QEs as one. The Fed's balance sheet is expanding at a pace it had never expanded before. Rapid money printing, ultra accommodative, ultra loose, all the financial press uniformly and saying this is reckless money printing. This is unbelievably powerful stuff. And yet in February 2013, market-based measures of inflation expectations begin to drop. They drop from a high level, one of the highest levels on record, of course, but they begin to fall. And, you know, looking at it from an overview, they've only gone downhill ever since. So why was February 2013 kind of the top in inflation expectations, market-based inflation expectations? That's really the question.
Jeff, the star of the show is going to be the Treasury inflation protected security and the break-evens and the market-based inflation expectations. But you mentioned repurchase agreements in your explanation there, and that there were fails in the repurchase agreement market. And the repurchase agreement market is where banks, or I would think financial institutions, go to acquire short-term funding, and they put up collateral for that short-term funding, primarily U.S. treasuries, but they can put up other assets as well. So Jeff, there were repo fails taking place at that time. Why?
Yeah, there was not just repo fails, not just that. There was all sorts of weird indications and warnings from the repo market. For example, there were several times when general collateral rates, or you know, specific collateral rates, would go way down. They would these particular securities in the repo market, particular pieces of treasury collateral, would trade wicked special, right down to the fails penalty, which is, you know, which is supposed to be a floor where, you know, fail, it's supposed to prevent fails, rather than getting into that, we'll set that one aside. Anyway, there's a lot of stuff going on in the repo market in early 2013. And the general sense of it was that, damn, here we go again. This stuff keeps happening. We have all of these massive money printing QEs, bank reserves going, you know, the level of bank reserves flying upward. Yet we keep having these illiquid, disruptive problems in the central location of, as you pointed out, you know, it's not just short-term funding. It's banks go into these markets and financial firms go into these markets for short-term funding, but they roll it over day after day after day. So yes, it's short-term funding, but it's short-term funding that these financial participants use over the long run. And the reason that's a problem is because if you're rolling over funding day after day after day using certain collateral, and tomorrow all of a sudden the collateral you've been using is hard to come by or it's not negotiable, you have a big problem because you're depending upon rolling over funding day after day after day. And the day comes where it becomes more difficult. What happens? Well, you start changing your behavior because you're looking at these liquidity and monetary risks as impeding your own survival. They're disrupting your business, but you have to change the way you do things. And the way you change, the way financial firms change the way they do things is very deflationary, not inflationary. They take less risk, not more risk. So we have this disconnect. Again, QE3, QE4 going full throttle. And at the same time, repo market disruptions that the market itself began to say, this is deflationary. And by the way, we've seen this many times before. It's not getting fixed. So maybe this is something that never will get fixed.
Let me show everyone a graph of just what you said so they can imagine that visually. They'll be seeing the private banking system going in the other direction. It's getting deflationary, while at the same time, what are we seeing from the central bank? I thought this was an amazing graph.
Yeah, at the same time that the Fed's going nuts, right? It's the money printing, ultra accommodation, ultra loose monetary policy, yet inflation expectations begin to drop considerably largely because of all, not just the repo, but other things, but largely because of these repo collateral problems, which, by the way, quantitative easing as it itself makes worse because QE, especially in this period between February and I believe June, even before February, between the start of QE4 in late 2012 and around June 2013, the Federal Reserve was buying on-the-run treasuries. It was taking the best collateral out of the marketplace. It's just as it had done before buying treasury bills in QE2, for example. So the Fed is removing the best collateral. It's starting to create all of these enormous problems in the repo market, noticeable problems that banks understood would create deflationary behavior going forward. And the fact that this is, it's 2013, you know, 4.5 years after the crisis, and we're still seeing these problems, they started to get the message that this thing would never be not a problem. The QE isn't going to do anything. Bank reserves don't really help. And repo and collateral and the dollar system as a whole, all that stuff, that the trillions that take place outside what the Fed cares about, this stuff is going to be a consistent problem. So from that time period forward, market-based measures of inflation expectations have, not in a straight line, but over time, they've been downhill.
Market-based inflation expectations warned us something was wrong. And yet, there's a problem, Jeff, because according to a very recent Bloomberg article, it's not quite clear where people should look to for inflation expectations. And here, let me read a quote. The Federal Reserve, this is from Bloomberg article, the Federal Reserve is determined to push inflation higher from levels it considers dangerously low. For that to happen, it must first convince everyone that prices will accelerate in the coming years. One big problem is that measures that bond traders and strategists rely on for longer run inflation expectations can often give conflicting and confusing signals, Jeff. No one can agree on how to best use or decipher them, with even the Fed seemingly reticent to narrow it down. Jeff,
It's not conflicting or confusing. We both agree about that. I mean, there's no conflict or confusion here. There's only a conflict if you believe in the Fed. And remember, the first part of the quote you just read is absolutely correct. The Fed has to try to make you believe inflation's coming because inflation is dangerously low. And remember, we're not really talking about consumer prices here. That's not the issue. consumer low levels of inflation are usually correspond with low levels of economic growth, which we cannot afford right now. We need rapid economic growth. And so inflation in a lot of ways is a check on our assumptions. If we believe inflation is going to happen a year from now, that's a good thing, you know, because the economy is roaring its way back. It's going back. It's coming back so fast. It's going to create excesses, and that excess is going to show up in consumer prices. So the Fed has to convince us that because everything's bad right now, that things are going to be good next year. And the way they convince us is what? By more quantitative easing. And so the market-based measures of inflation expectation are saying, no, we've seen this before. This QE stuff doesn't work. We're not convinced by it. So there is no confusion except if you believe in QE, which, by the way, is the vast majority of the population, I believe, because most people just take whatever Jay Powell says at his word, because why wouldn't they? They've been brought up to believe the Federal Reserve is a central bank, not a domestic bank regulator. And even if they do realize it's a domestic bank regulator, I don't think people understand the difference. And on top of that, they don't ever hear about, I mean, the term euro dollar is, I don't think many people have ever even heard of it, let alone understand what it is. So they don't even know that there's this massive monetary system out there that they should be paying attention to, that central bankers don't even pay attention to. And so the confusion comes in from, if you're looking at these things from the mainstream conventional perspective, yeah, these low inflation expectations seem to be confusing because they're telling you that what you're not supposed to believe. The market is saying this QE stuff, bank reserves, all this money printing crap, it is crap. We don't buy it. We're not buying. We're literally not buying it.
If you put the Earth at the center of the solar system, then the path of the planets is confusing. Jeff, the same day that you wrote your article, the Consumer Price Index for the United States was released by the Bureau of Labor Statistics for the month of September. They talked about the overall rate edging up to 1.4% from 1.3% in August. I guess that's good. That's inflationary. But core consumer prices, the news wasn't that good there for the Fed's inflationary push.
Yeah, most of the headline inflation is due to oil prices. Well, not really oil prices, but oil prices as it flow through gasoline and other energy stuff. And so, you know, a lot of times you look at the core rates because oil can be noisy at times. It's all over the place. When you look at some of the core rates, not only did they stumble in September, they stumbled at a level that is already amongst the lowest in the series. So we're not seeing the types of deep-seated inflation pressures that would be consistent with the idea the Fed has created this drastically inflationary future. So we have inflation expectations that are likewise, even though they've come up from March, they remain, I think when I ran the numbers, it's the 12th percentile. Tips, whether it's the five-year five-year forward, the five-year break-even, or the 10-year break-even, they're all around the 10th, 11th, 12th, 13th percentile, which means 87% of the time or more, inflation expectations have been higher. And that, I mean, again, the disconnect, right? All this money printing, massive balance sheet expansion, markets are saying, we don't buy this inflation story. And then the CPI comes along and reinforces the message because it shows, yes, there are no inflation pressures. In fact, what we're looking at is more in balance, disinflationary pressures of the kind that, you know, reminded such particularly market participants of early 2013. Rapid growth in the Fed's balance sheet, but yet not it's not turning out the way it's supposed to.
And market participants are not the only ones who are not buying it. Consumers seem to not be buying it as well. The same day that the CPI was released, the Federal Reserve Branch of New York released its consumer survey for the month of September. And normally, you know, it doesn't matter what one particular month is, but September followed August's big announcement with all the fancy press clippings and the media campaign to tell everyone that the Federal Reserve was going to let inflation run pure. What do consumers think of that? Well, the results showed that the median three-year ahead expected inflation rate decreased by 24 basis points from August to 2.74%. And that corroborates the earlier survey for the month of September by the University of Michigan. That one showed that the five-year ahead expected inflation rate decreased by 10 basis points to 2.6, and the 1 year ahead decreased by 40 basis points to 2.7%.
Yeah, those are big moves, right? I mean, 40 basis points for the 1 year Michigan is a big move, as is the 24 basis points for the FARB and Y number. These are not small declines. And there, again, the time period matters, right? And you pointed it out exactly. The Fed, Jay Powell, made this big deal about average inflation targeting. We're doing massive QE. We're raising our level of what will allow inflation to get to. That's what the central bank is saying. We're doing massive money printing, and we're going to let it run as hot as it can possibly get. And yet consumers kind of just went, eh, as did the markets. The markets kind of went, eh. You look at nominal treasury yields, eh. Nobody is buying the inflation story because it's a boring, predictable story that's all fiction. It's not a real story.
Jeff, since 2018, if you took a look at the inflation break-even for the 10-year treasury bond, you would see that after each policy proposal, the inflation that the Federal Reserve or policy pivot, inflation expectations started to move up. As you often said, they kind of were exploring the possibility. But then after every, what would the word be? Every transitory issue that kept coming up and every obstacle that showed up, we would see a ratcheting down of that inflation expectations. And since March, inflation expectations have been heading up until August 31st, the Monday after the big policy proposal announcement. Ever since then, inflation expectations, the break even from the 10-year US Treasury has been flatlined. We saw an inflection just like we have before, and it had ratcheted down from the previous level since 2018.
Yeah, I think that average inflation target was, for any honest and unbiased market observer, or even just any observer whatsoever, what Jay Powell announced at the virtual conference in Jackson Hole in late August was a tremendous disappointment, because they made this huge deal out of it, and most people probably weren't aware of it. But I mean, going back to December of 2018, for a year and a half, they put a tremendous amount of time and effort into it. And they made it sound like this was, hey, we're being honest here. We're going to pull everything apart and look under every rock and see what can we do to improve. And I think they set themselves up for failure because they were setting the expectation that this was going to be a really good thing. Again, always expectations. This was going to be really good. And the market thought, okay, after 12 years of QE or so, they're going to come up with something different, and something different might work. That's always the formula, right? If we do something different, different has a chance to work, whereas same has absolutely no chance of working. And instead, Jay Powell announces his average inflation target, and you could just hear the air go out of all the balloons because it wasn't anything different. I mean, go back to forward guidance and symmetrical target and all that. It's the same damn thing. And on top of it, it's not just average inflation target. It's average inflation target, which depends upon more QE as its background. And it's just the market went, huh? This was supposed to be great, and this is what your big idea was? And instead, what you realize is they don't have any ideas. They're out of ideas, and that's really disappointing. And in one sense, in terms of expectations, it's disinflationary itself.
You know what they need is not just more QE, but more QQE, which is what we're going to be discussing right now in part three. Everyone else, if you are enjoying this work, you can find Jeff Snider on Twitter at Jeff_Snider_AIP. He writes at Real Clear Markets once a week. And you can also see him and his posts daily at the Alhambra Investments blog roll.